I want to welcome you to the Punxsutawney Alliance Church and this Palm Sunday celebration. As we come before the Lord today, let me remind you of a couple things. First of all, last year in 2020, on Palm Sunday, we moved our services out into our parking lot. And we're in the parking lot in our ministry, in rejoicing in church and our worship of Jesus from Palm Sunday until June the 6th. So just wanted you to realize this is kind of an anniversary for us. I also want to share with you that as we come today, that I want you to be reminded that we're going to be looking at Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and we're going to be looking at the accounts that are found in Scripture of the triumphal entry of Jesus. And so we're going to be flipping back and forth between those four Gospels. So you might want to take the opportunity, like I've done with mine, to mark your Bible, maybe put a sticker note or a page mark in there. Matthew chapter 21, Mark chapter 11, Luke chapter 19, and John chapter 12. We'll be looking back and forth through those things. As we begin this morning, I want to turn your attention to the Gospel of John and want to read to you these words. This is in context of the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ, what we call Palm Sunday, which is the beginning of what we call in the church calendar of Passion Week or Holy Week. It says this, Gospel of John, chapter 12, verse 16. His disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. So the question, which is really the title of today's sermon, is what's all this mean? Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry of Jesus. What's all this mean? In that passage of scripture, it says that his disciples did not understand these things at first. But when he was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. These passages that we're going to look at kind of collate for us what this event means. It's not just Palm Sunday. It's not just the beginning of Passion Week or Holy Week. It's not just the triumphal entry. There is a reason why this event is in your Bibles. There is a reason why this event finds itself in all four of the Gospels. Many times you will find that many things are found in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which are called synoptic Gospels because they're similar. John, however, is different from the other three Gospels. It focuses more on a tighter time frame. But all four of the Gospels have this account in it. And so there's a reason why God wants us to take a look at it and know there's a reason, there's a meaning for this event. And so we're going to take a look at it as we begin today. Bow your heads and your hearts with mine. Lord Jesus, I want to come before you right now and ask that you would help us, go before us, be with us, encourage us. And especially, Lord, let us experience praise and glory and honor and blessing to you and to you alone. And I'll thank you as we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. There are four points to this morning's outline. One is fulfillment of prophecy. The second is spontaneous praise and worship. Third is intensity, and then the fourth is prophetic proclamation. These are what this event means. And so we're going to take a look at that together. First of all, turn in your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 21 and in verse 4. Matthew chapter 21 and verse 4. It says this. In Matthew chapter 21 verse 4, it says, and this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of the donkey. That passage of scripture is one in which we take a look at today, realizing that it is a fulfillment of prophecy. Go back again, if you would, to John chapter 12. And again, remember, we're going to go back between these gospel accounts. And so I want to do that as quickly as we can. So I've got mine marked. In John chapter 12, it tells us this in verse 16. His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, they remembered that these things were written about him. These things were written about him. And then later on in the Gospel of John chapter 27, he proclaims this. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I came to this hour. I want you to see these prophetic fulfillments. The first is, of course, the one in which we read that he is going to come on the foal, on the colt of a donkey. That is found in Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9. It is one of the things that in the restoration of the high priesthood and the priesthood that they were to look for. It was a sign of Messiah, that he would come not on a great big white charger, not in a great big wagon or chariot, not in some great big entourage of a panoply of glory. He was going to come on a colt of a donkey. Totally antithetical to everything else you ever want to see in the idea of ruling. So it is a prophetic voice. In Psalm 118, it says, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. That comes from Psalm 118, verse 26. Again, another sign of the Messiahship. He's going to come. He is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. He is the Son of David. He is claimed to be King of Israel. Now, I want you to realize that these prophecies came about so that there would be the proof of who Jesus is as the Son of Man, the Son of God, our Messiah, our Lord, our Christ. But that the John passage in verse 27 through 28 points to something else. It points to this. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? That's a question. But for this purpose, what is the purpose? Jesus is going to begin the end of his earthly ministry. Everything that he has taught, everything that he has lived out in the past 3.5 years of his life has been focused into a point. That's why point 3 of this sermon talks about intensity, but we're not there yet. Let me come back and remind you that there was a purpose. These things just did not happen haphazardly. They did not happen because somebody decided, oh, wouldn't it be a good thing to have a big parade in Jerusalem today? That's not how they happened. They were prophetic. And here we find that they are being fulfilled. Somebody took the opportunity to calculate how one person could fulfill all the prophetic statements about the Messiah. And I forget what the chances were. And you say, well, you should have looked that up before the sermon. It was beyond probability almost. And so these things all testify to the person and work of Jesus Christ. Jesus doesn't point to the probability of who he is. He pointed to what he had done and what he is doing. And in this case, the proclamation of who he is from Psalm 118 and the proclamation of how he is coming into Jerusalem, those proclamations are identifying marks of his messiahship, his lordship. And his purpose is that he might fulfill redemption, that Jesus is going to come and pay a price. He's going to ransom and redeem us. He's going to become our atonement for sin. He's going to become the gate by which we go through to have a relationship with God. That is his purpose. He is the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. When he was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he was travailing in that moment, my opinion is he was not thinking about whether he would go to the cross or whether he wouldn't. He knew he was going to die. It is the purpose for which he has come into the world. My opinion is that he was anguished over what he was going to have to endure physically, the suffering, death itself. He's facing that. He knows it's coming. And he knows that crucifixion, because he created the body and fearfully, wonderfully made it, he knew what crucifixion was going to do to that body. But his purpose was never never questioned his purpose. Am I going to do this or aren't I going to do this? Is Don Jones worth saving or isn't he? Those are not the questions he asks in Gethsemane. What he says here is, why would I doubt my purpose? I have this purpose. So in this passage of Scripture, this event, whether we call it Palm Sunday, whether we call it the beginning of the Holy Week, whether we call it the triumphal entry, it is the fulfillment of prophecy. It was preordained by God that this would happen so that his son would be recognized and that we might take a look back as the disciples did and see what the purpose was. What's all this mean? Well, first of all, this just didn't happen out of chance. It was the fulfillment of prophecy. The second thing that we see about this event, Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry, the beginning of Passion or Holy Week, is the spontaneous praise and worship. Again, let's go back to Matthew. We're going to look in Matthew chapter 21 and in verse 14. Matthew chapter 21, then verse 14. It says this, "Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed him. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple and saying, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they were indignant and said to him, 'Do you hear what these are saying?' And Jesus said to them, 'Yes, have you never read, out of the mouths of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise?'" So in this event, there is this praise. Now I want you to turn with me to the Gospel of Luke. And we're going to look at same time frame and area. Luke chapter 19 and in verse 40, we have the same thing. In verse 39, it says, "And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' But he answered and said to them, 'I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out.'" There have been some great Christian songs written about the stones crying out in his praise. This spontaneous praise and worship. A couple more passages. In John chapter 12, we read this in verse 9. John chapter 12, verse 9. "Now a great many of the Jews knew that he was there," where? He was at Lazarus, Mary, and Martha's. "And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but they might also see Lazarus, whom he raised from the dead." Go a few more passages and go to verse 17 and 18. "Therefore the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of his tomb and raised him from the dead bore witness. For this reason the people also met him, because they heard that he had done this great sign." The Pharisees in verse 19 said, "Therefore among themselves, 'You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the whole world has gone after him.' Oh, I wish that was true." Let's take a look at this spontaneous worship. You know the account as well as I do, that they took from the trees, palm branches, palm fronds. We have some of them here today at church. And they take off their outer clothing and they lay the palms and they lay the clothing in front of Jesus as he goes down the street. We know that they raise them and praise God with them and wave them. We know that there's some singing and shouting, stomping going on. Let's take a look at them spreading their clothes and the palms. First of all, this was done in honor of someone, a high dignitary, an emperor or a governor may warrant this type of event. It was honor. It was honoring to that individual to lay their clothing before him, to take and to lay down those palm branches. In many areas, this idea was the victory parade. in NASCAR, it's the victory lap. Okay? It is to symbolize victory. They have come to honor and they are come to proclaim victory. And they are expressing their exaltation of who Jesus is. Remember, the focus of those clothes to honor him, the focus of those palm fronds to honor him, the exaltation to praise him, that honor and that victory and that exaltation is really, really important. One of the things I want you to realize that they're singing, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They're shouting of the glory to God for what he has done, and they're stomping, and I just kind of used that because it went with singing and shouting. And that shouting is really interesting. I don't know if you've ever been in the Holy Land, but if you have been in the Holy Land, it's interesting to see how far the Mount of Olives is from Jerusalem. Now, here's the thing I want you to realize. As they came into Jerusalem, they could be heard. Over a mile away, they could be heard. Somebody's singing loud. Somebody's shouting. I remember a T-shirt that came out of the men's ministry, and you know, really, really great Promise Keepers movement, and it read, "Real men sing real loud." I really like that. So they were a loud, exultant crowd. They were waving the palm branches. They were putting their clothing before him in the street. They were singing. They were shouting. They were stomping, and they were heard over a mile away. That's some kind of noise. That's some kind of praise. We can barely get out of zero decibel amen. But boy, they were excited. Now, there's another thing that I want you to see here, and I don't want you to miss, because sometimes we do miss it when we talk about the triumphal entry. A right reading of the Gospel of John will show you that one of the reasons why this crowd was so excited was because Lazarus was there. This passage of Scripture says something that's really incredible, that many of the people came to see Jesus, but they also wanted to see Lazarus. Look, Lazarus healing from the dead, his healing from death, his coming out of that tomb after 4 days at the word of Jesus was not a secret, was not kept secret. People knew him, people saw him, people knew he died. They even attended his funeral. And here he is alive, and he's alive because Jesus went to a cemetery and cried out his name. These people were excited. They are excited not just because of Jesus, but here walking along with Jesus, as I would see it, is the perfect example of the power of his ministry. Here was Lazarus, alive, dead and buried 4 days. They knew him. They experienced him. Can you imagine what dinner conversation at Mary and Martha and Lazarus's house was every night they had dinner? Well, Lazarus, what was it like to be dead? You know, we came to mourn with your sisters, and all of a sudden Jesus wept and called your name, and there you came out. I want you to understand that their exaltation, that their singing, their shouting, and their boisterous, anticipatory worship of God came out of the fact that Jesus had done all the things, all the miracles that had been prophesied about Messiah, and the pinnacle of it was raising somebody from the dead. Now remember, Lazarus was not raised from the dead to a glorified body. Lazarus died again, in essence. Church history and tradition tells us that he became a bishop in a church. Now I don't know how far you want to take that, but we know that he lived beyond this moment. But part of what was going on that day was not only Jesus, but what he did. Never forget that. It is the fulfillment of prophecy and his prophetic works. Remember when John the Baptist was in prison and he sent a messenger to Jesus and he said, ask him, are you the one we are seeking or there another? Do you remember what Jesus said? Jesus said to him, look, the blind see, the lame walk, and the gospel is preached. I'm who I say it I am. I'm who John claimed me to be. And standing right next to him on this triumphal entry day is a man who was dead, buried, funeral service over, mourning beginning, alive. That's powerful, and that's why they were excited, and that's why, in my opinion, they were stomping. There's another thing I want you to see about this event, and that's found in Matthew chapter 21, and I want to read verses 14 through 17. Matthew chapter 21, verses 14 through 17. Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. And they said to him, do you hear what these are saying? And Jesus said to them, yes, have you never read out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise? Then he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, and he lodged there. Intensity. Rebuke your disciples. Don't let them say this about you. Don't you understand this is blasphemy? Don't you understand what they're saying? You've got to stop them. In Luke chapter 19, and in verse 39, it says this, and some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, teacher, rebuke your disciples. But he answered and said to them, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would cry out immediately. Go back to John chapter 12, and in verse 23, it tells us, but Jesus answered them saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Not only a prophetic word and a fulfillment of prophecy, but it is also Jesus coming, showing the intensity. Rebuke your disciples. I won't rebuke my disciples. They are proclaiming who I am and what I've done. And then he is telling them that he is going to be lifted up. Notice with me that Jesus makes that claim for you and for me. In verse 32, it says, and if I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all peoples to myself. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And Jesus comes proclaiming again in his power and in his glory that if he would be lifted up, if he would be crucified, he is signifying by the way in which he will die, there is an intensity. This week is going to be intense. There's going to be those who deny him and reject him. You have the incredible event of the triumphal entry, and it won't be a week before they're standing in the marketplace of Jerusalem crying for him to be crucified. Here they are one day crying Hosanna to the Son of David, and another day saying, we don't want Jesus, give us Barabbas. The intensity, the scrutiny, the focus has changed. And that's part of this reason why and what this means. What's all this mean? Well, it means that there is coming an intensity. If you thought some of Jesus' other contexts, ministry, events were intense, nothing is going to be like this, because ultimately the intensity of this event, the intensity of these days, are going to lead to his crucifixion on the cross. that intensity, that winding up, that getting ready for the end. And we know that it's really not the end at his crucifixion. But I mean, it is the wind-up, folks, to use a euphemism from baseball. It's the wind-up. And that's really important. God has said in the fullness of time, boom, in the fullness of time, Jesus is coming to this world. And in the fullness of time, not chance, not something arbitrary, in this moment, at this point, in this place, that intensity is going to increase. That intensity is going to be increased in many of his ministry statements, and it is ultimately going to end in his death and his ultimate resurrection. Let me invite you for a moment to think of that event in that day. We know about the palm branches, and we know about the clothing. We know about the noise. We know about the singing. We know about the proclamation. We even have some idea of who is there. You have those who follow Jesus in his ministry. There are those who wanted to meet him. There are plenty of people in and around the environs of Jerusalem because it's Passover. Jerusalem would swell to almost 1 million people during Passover. They wanted to see Jesus. In fact, in this period of time, there are a group of people who say, "Sir, we would see Jesus." But while Jesus is in this intensity, he makes some prophetic statements. He makes some prophetic statements. So turn with me, if you would, to Luke, and in chapter 19, verses 41 through 44. It says this: "Now as he drew near to the city, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, 'If you had known, even you, especially in your day, the things that make for your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you, and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation.'" Go back, if you would, to John chapter 12. Passages that we've looked at, but let's look at them again in verse 30. Jesus says, "This voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And if I am lifted up, I will..." "And if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." This he said, signifying by what death he would die. Jesus talking about his cross. And then a little later on in that 12th chapter, he proclaims this in verses 44 through 48. "Then Jesus cried out and said, 'He who believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me. And he who sees me sees him who sent me. I have come as a light into the world, and whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. And if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I do not judge him. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day.'" Jesus is making prophetic proclamations. The first thing he says is Jerusalem is going to be destroyed. And Jerusalem is going to be destroyed in just about 30 some odd years. And Jerusalem is going to have an embankment set up against it, and it's going to have its stones overturned, its walls destroyed, its temple taken apart stone by stone. In 70 AD, the legions of Titus completed their victory over what we call the Holy Land, Israel in its day. And they were told of the gold and the precious metals that were in the temple. And if you went to the Holy Land today, and if you went to Jerusalem, you'd see an area where there's a bunch of tumbled stones. Because of the fire, the soldiers, I have read, thought that the gold got in between the cracks. So what they did was they tore it apart stone by stone, looking for this precious metal. And Jerusalem was besieged. And in that siege, all sorts of horrific things happened in the city as the Romans tightened their clench against their neck until they finally surrendered, and then they sacked and pillaged the city of God. Jerusalem was destroyed, and Jesus predicted it. He predicted it earlier. In fact, a little bit later, when Jesus goes to trial, somebody's going to say that Jesus had told them that somebody was going to tear down the temple. Well, it got torn down. His prophetic word. Look at his passion and look at his burden. Look at his heartache as he weeps over this city as they miss the hour of their visitation. He is still weeping over people who miss the hour of their visitation. He is still weeping over those who walk away and contrary for him, just as he rejoices and all heaven does with one soul that comes to the Lord. He is prophesying Jerusalem's destruction. He is prophesying his death, and he is prophesying that redemption is going to be paid in full, that he was and is the sacrifice, the ultimate sacrifice. He is the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. He is the one who will transform and change us and make us to know and make us to experience a relationship with God that is fulfilling, that is eternal, and that can begin in our lives right here, right now, as we walk with him, awaiting that day when we will see him face to face. What's all this mean? If it was not something that just happened, boom, but if it was planned, and it was, what's its meaning? What does this event signify? It signifies that God told us ahead of time about himself and about this event so that we would recognize who Jesus is, not only then, but now. To my knowledge, no other conqueror has ever entered into a city on the back of the colt of a donkey, on a colt that had never been ridden before. I want you to realize that the praise and the worship of Jesus here came out of the fact that Lazarus was risen from the dead. But there is a greater resurrection coming for you and for me, a resurrection that was pointed to in Jesus' resurrection, who became the first fruit, and one day we will be raised. There is that spontaneous praise and worship that comes out of the love and the goodness and the power and the person of God, and that it changes us, causes us to sing, causes us to shout, causes us to move in our lives to acknowledge him, to honor him as the Lord of glory, to proclaim that Jesus gives us the victory, a song by A.B. Simpson in our Alliance hymnals, and an exaltation of him. It tells us that the point of his death and resurrection is going to intensify. Things in our lives have a tendency to intensify. Jesus' ministry is going to come to that intense point where he cries on the cross, "It is finished." And when the disciples and the women who were part of the believers of his day heard, "He is not risen. He's not here. He is risen just as he said. In that moment, he told of the destruction. He told that he was going to die. But he also told them, the purpose of my being here is to fulfill redemption, to pay the cost, your purchase price, my purchase price in full. He prophetically told us that. I want you to realize, and I want to encourage you right now, that you look at what this means and just not realize like it's the Sunday before Easter. No, it meant something. I don't want us to just look at it and say, well, you know, it's Palm Sunday. You know, we always do this in spring, and boy, it's a wonderful time, and everything's getting green and all. I want you to realize there was a different significance for it. There was a meaning that God wanted to communicate to those in his day, though they did not understand it fully. But also to every believer who has ever walked with Jesus to understand the meaning of this day, to embrace the meaning of this day, to live knowing that Jesus has fulfilled prophecy, to live a life of praise and worship and adoration and exaltation, to realize being a believer is intense, can be intense. And to remember that Jesus told us about this so we'd know. And in knowing, delight in him. What's all this mean? That's what it means. Pray with me. Lord, I come before you right now and thank you for the opportunity to open your word, to look at a familiar event. And in that familiar event, delight in the person who is the whole point of it. And Lord, I'll ask this and pray this in your mighty and blessed name. And all the people said, Amen.